poor wireless connection. Hi and welcome back. I'm Namita Ramani, founder and CEO of Above Digital, a digital marketing agency established in 2004 for all those of you who are new to my show. We help businesses grow using online marketing. I'm also a coach and a mentor, and I help and teach entrepreneurs and small businesses on how to generate, basically grow their businesses using digital marketing. We have an online academy, and the academy is called aboutdigitalacademy.com. Today's show is really special. We are with Mubarakka, my pottery teacher, and it's a story about a woman who went through hardships in her life to run the family, you know, precisely. Before I get into the conversation with Mubarakka and introduce her, I would like to thank you all for taking time to watch this show and be with me. Please like or comment so I know you can see me and you can hear me. And while I wait for that, I want to share with you all what happened that last couple of weeks that I was not, we didn't do these Monday lives. And the reason for that is because I wanted to strengthen the value that we bring to these live shows, the people that I bring, the conversations that we have. I want to make sure that whatever content we are sharing, these stories, these inspirational entrepreneurs who come and share their personal life and their stories, not only just leaves us inspired, but also gives some more actionable steps and more value. So me with my team, we put together an entire plan. We sat down and we planned the rest of the year's live show. So hopefully in the coming lives, we'll be sharing some very interesting talks on digital marketing. We'll have more inspiring entrepreneurs join us on the show and share their journey with you all. And without further delay, I would like to now introduce Mubarakka. Mubarakka is a simple and an inspiring entrepreneur. She's a mother, she's a wife. And we will hear her personal story as she starts, you know, sharing the information with us. But she had to turn her hobby, her passion, her hobby into her, which was her passion sort of, into a business to support her family. So Mubarakka, I would like to come to you now and share with us your story.
Thank you, Namita, for having me over. This is special for me because not only am I come to someone like you who yourself is an entrepreneur, but also you're my student. Yeah. And so it's
difficult a very, student.
So it's a very special moment for me. Yeah. Because, you know, I've started my pottery about 5 years back. Mm-hmm. And before that, I was a homemaker. Before that, I come from Bombay. And I've had quite a difficult childhood. By, you know, the age of 10, I lost my father. So we were two sisters, my sister is elder to me. And we had to take care of things because we were brought up in a way that my father was there. And all of a sudden, one fine day, he's not there. So we knew what struggle was. So I would think that struggle is very important for you to be successful. Yeah. Because if you don't struggle, you don't appreciate. It's like when you fall down, you don't want to fall down again because you know it hurts.
Yeah.
Right? So I came to Dubai about 20 years back and with a 1-year-old in my hand. And my husband had got a job here and we started. It was quite... happy coming here because I had few people who I know live here, and we came from Nepal, which where my son was born. That's mm-hmm. why my son's name is Shikhar, which means a mountain peak.
Yeah.
And we came here, and yeah, initially we struggled because the Middle East was different. We never lived here. I had come with a 3-year-old. I was not sure whether I would get a job. So I started off within about 3 months. I got a job. I was working. I worked for about a year and a half, and then I felt with my son, little, you know, he was just about 3 and he was about 5. We were putting him in the babysitter. And so we thought, okay, I should stop working. It was a decision which I do regret now because I think if I had continued to work, I would have been also financially more stable.
Mm-hmm.
So it would have helped me in my business today.
Okay.
Because then I decided that, you know, I had nothing to do at home because my son used to go in school, my husband was working, and I had quit my job. And then I said, okay, I want to learn pottery, so let's make it, you know, let's go for classes. And that's how I started. I yet give all credit to my pottery teacher. She's an amazing lady. And I started it as a hobby, never thinking it's going to be my profession one day. Mm-hmm. Never. Because I never thought that I could go to that level.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I had never thought that I could be an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. I was also made to feel that, yeah, I'm a homemaker, I'm doing good. But when I quit my job, mm-hmm. I was at home, right? Yeah. And from there, about, I think, 5 years back,
mm-hmm.
it was, my husband was, you know, going through his own share of ups and downs with his career. He wanted a break in his career. And then we felt that I wish I was working. So I
suddenly
could, yeah, there was that sudden where
desire that I wish my wife was working.
Yeah. So I could have taken a break,
yeah,
and she could, you know, continue. So
yeah.
I'm not working for 12 years. It was not easy, Namita, for
yeah.
me to get another, to get a job just offhand.
Yeah, yeah.
Obviously not. And then I looked for a job. I applied. I got a few calls, but the salary was not even enough for me to, I think, feed 3 mouths.
Yeah.
So then I decided, let me see my hobby.
When he said feed 3 mouths, he just decided to stop working.
He did. He thought he's going to take a break for some time. He was working. Then he said about 6 months down the line, he does want to quit and, you know, do something of his own, maybe write a book or... So it came sudden, but maybe it was good in the way because that's when something in me came out. Yeah.
Do the work.
Yeah.
So was it not possible that you had enough savings to take care of the family and pay the expenses and school?
It was initially, but you know, as you say, Namita, you can't depend on your savings. You don't want to get into your investment or your savings. So you want an income to be coming into the house.
Yeah.
And I had stopped working. I was not in the corporate world. No one would take me. You know,
yeah.
these days, corporate world, you know how it is. You know, people want you to have experience.
Yeah.
They want younger. I was about 39 years old. So no one's going to take you.
Yeah.
So that's when Touch of Clay happened. But that was also not easy because, you know, it's an SME.
To start a business also requires investment.
Exactly.
Time is one.
Yeah.
You have license fees. You have
yeah.
government fees.
And then
tenancy contract.
It was Dubai is also somewhere where you need also investment. It's not something like, you know, back home where everything just falls in place.
Mm-hmm.
So being in another country, you need to have the right amount of funds, the right amount of contacts.
Mm-hmm.
And I was had never done something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it had to come all by myself. So make a business plan, submit it to the free zone authorities, then get a license. But I think I'm grateful for what happened because otherwise I would have been the same homemaker, which I think is nice, but I needed to move on.
But for 12 years that you were a homemaker and you didn't come out to do something,
yeah.
at that time you didn't have this urge to go ahead and start doing something?
I think I had, but I'm very content as a person.
Yeah.
I thought that this is, and I was very happy with my little family. And, you know, going out in the evenings when my husband would come home and my son going to school, waiting for him when his school bus would come.
Like a nice Indian
yeah,
movie.
Yeah. And I think I forgot that there's something in me that can happen.
Wants to come.
And as a childhood, as a child also, I always wanted to be a businesswoman because I've seen my father. He ran his own industry
mm-hmm.
and he died very early. And I had always wanted to take charge of his company.
Why didn't you?
Because after he died, my uncles and all thought they couldn't manage it, so they sold the business. And I was only 10, my sister was 12.
Yeah, of course.
And we couldn't even think of
yeah.
it. But today,
yeah.
as a child, I would go to his factory, I would see what he's doing. And even at that time, his friends would tell him, this is your heir to your empire.
Yeah.
So that was, I think, that is there in me. So when I started Touch of Clay, I think that came out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So Touch of Clay started that way, and today it's 5 years old. I have around 100 students. I teach from 3-year-olds to 85. Namita is my student and she's trying to make beautiful things. She doesn't believe in herself, but we have to get her to do that.
You know, just
what do you think,
this last Saturday I go for my classes and she was asking me, like, I just, you know, I told her, why do I come to these classes? Do you know? I think one of the biggest problem that I have is one is patience.
Hmm.
So I think working with clay teaches me how to be patient. And another problem I have is of letting go and stopping to judge myself. Forget anybody else judging me.
True.
But I myself judge my own made things. And a lot of times it has so happened that I would spend days in creating this piece, and I would just give it up because it's not to my liking.
And in pottery, we always say let go. The minute you let go, no one is looking at you. No one is judgmental.
Yeah.
Everyone is doing, and whatever you make with clay, with your hands, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
So it's taken Namita a little time, but I think we're getting
there. I'm still working in perfection. Yeah. Like, you know, I want everything to be perfectly round and perfectly, you know, structured. And it's never perfect because it has those hand marks when you're making things in pottery. And
but the joy of making something with your hand and seeing that you have created it. It's like creating a baby, right? You create and then drinking from it or eating from a, you know, from a cup that you have made or giving it to your loved ones, that I have made it for you, not bought it from a shop. You know? Literally made it for you. So yeah, the journey's not been easy, but I don't have any regrets. I think it has taken me to another level.
Mm-hmm.
It has made me more confident. I've met some of the most beautiful people in these 5 years. From students, they've become friends. I've met people from all over the world. Mm-hmm. I have students from about 20 or, you know, 25 nationalities, from Indians, Pakistanis, Spanish, European, American, and it's family.
So how did you make this? These number of students, like when you started, you didn't have, did you have enough funds to do marketing?
I didn't do any marketing.
Did you know how to do sales?
No, I didn't. So mine is a pure word of mouth. I had 5 students I started with, and I think
How did these people come?
They were my friends who knew about that I'm starting, so they came and
to
my
support you.
Yeah, my studio was in the garage, and my son used to always tell me that, Mom, be brave and be patient. Steve Jobs started in a garage. So, you know, Steve Jobs has created Apple. So, touch of clay should be there somewhere.
Yeah.
And I think that was important. I started small. I didn't do major investment.
Mm-hmm.
So, I thought, let's start small and then, you know, create. So even my tools or in my equipment, I didn't buy, like, you know, just bought everything and kept it. I bought what I needed.
So, you were selective in the way you're investing
And even for social media, I did everything on my own. I didn't go to someone professionally because I didn't have that kind of, you know, and my website was made by my sister because she's a branding designer. So it came quite well. The struggles, of course, I had because I didn't have a very high capital to work with. So whatever I earned, I used to put it back into my business.
Yeah.
But I think word of mouth was my biggest marketing.
Yeah.
When people started coming, then I started teaching in schools. That's where also a lot of people got to know me.
Right.
And I think I was meant for it. Things just fell in place.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, I struggled. I worked 7 days a week.
Yeah. Even now she works seven days a week. I think entrepreneurship is like a full-time job.
Full-time. I think I am working much more harder than someone who's a CEO of a company.
Yeah.
Because they at least have a pay package that comes every month. If I don't work hard, I don't get that because what I get is on my own.
Yeah.
So there's no question of it coming into the bank till I don't. And then, you know, the methods of getting a loan here are not easy for SMEs and a woman. I don't have more employees. So that's another thing. I do everything myself, from teaching to cleaning to marketing to uploading my pictures on social media.
She's a one-man woman.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. One-woman
show.
Still. Which is fantastic.
Yeah. And I think people ask me that, you know, what about your family and do they not miss you? But I think I gave so many of my years to them that now it's my time.
But Mubarakka, don't you think now if you have help, you can grow more faster?
You know, it's a gamble. I sometimes feel that I could do it. But you always think, and what if I hire somebody and then I, you know, that confidence has not yet come. But yes, I do want to expand. My dream is to have a cafe where I can have, like, you know, things which are made at home, which are not fine dining, an organic cafe where you have my studio on the side. I get people to do different workshops and I have artists from India. So that would be my dream come true.
You know, I would like to pause Mubarakka here and I would like to throw a light on this for all of you who are watching this or listening to this or maybe watching a replay of this session. I'm sure all of you in your minds have a similar dream for your businesses. Like,
absolutely.
Like one day I'll have this and I'll have
and
that
do it.
And I'll do this. But there has to be a stepping stone. There has to be a start. And any journey is not going to be easy.
Not
any journey is going to be tough.
I think, see, even my mother, like if I go to see, is herself, she struggled. She's without, my father died about 35 years back. single-handedly she's brought us up. Mm-hmm. And if I would not make my life successful, I think I would feel really bad for even her, because she's really worked hard to get us where we are. Mm-hmm. And my sister also is, you know, a branding designer. She's doing very well. It was me. And when I, now that I feel that I didn't work for so many years, there must be a reason. But I think if I had worked, I would have been somewhere else today. Maybe touch of care would not have happened. So maybe that would be the negative side of it.
Maybe. And because I think I recently had a similar conversation with someone when I was sharing with him about my past and how I had a different kind of upbringing in my schooling. That's right. A different episode altogether when I go into my past. And I always regret a lot of things that my parents didn't do for me.
True.
Which if I had studied in such schools or gone to the US to study or whatever, I would have been probably a different person. And that friend of mine told me that whatever you are, Namita, is because of what you went through in life. You wouldn't have had the guts to do what you do if you didn't face the hardships that you faced. The thing to prove myself, the thing to make money, the thing to come up and do something. All those were the driving factors to go up and stand on stage, like public speaking. I tell this to everyone that, you know, it's not my skill coming on these Facebook lives, you know, doing these shows. They intimidate me.
But I think you have to break out yeah. with your fears. That's when
you can prosper and yes. grow. And that, I think the growth is when you step out of your comfort zone and take that step. And
if you fall, it's good, because then you'll decide that I have to get better.
Yeah.
You know, so you have to fall to succeed. I'm sure you've seen a lot of failure. But yes. you've made that your success now.
That's how you learn, and then you take different steps to grow in the business. So coming back to Touch of Clay, how did you, you know, the kind of structure, like a student that comes to you, he pays you every 2 months. Like, you know, if I'm thinking the financial side of the business, just, I don't want to throw any numbers here or something, but a student that comes gives you payment for 2 months, for example, the basic package that you have, then how do you sustain the cycle? Because if I'm coming to you, I have to come for 8 times for you to charge me again.
Yeah.
So you have to wait for 2 months to make the next income from me. The price is not substantial. It's a very, you know, affordable pricing. So how did this business start sustaining a family?
See, what happens is not only...
when you started out, you know, because you started when your husband stopped working.
Yeah. So we had some savings, which I put into Touch of Clay. What we had, I took it as a loan that, okay, I'm going to put this into my business. Mm-hmm. And because I needed it, we needed about, you know, a good amount to start, as in even the licensing fees, the equipment. So that time, luckily, till the time I started, for about a year, my husband was yet working. So mm-hmm. we had a steady income going. Mm-hmm. So once he left, once 1 year of Touch of Clay was complete. So we did have that income, so I could have some of my savings. And I'm not the spendthrift kind of a person. So I could go ahead.
Yeah, but still, like, you know, the groceries and running the house and the bills and the rents is not ever enough in Dubai. It's a very expensive city.
I think initially we had a lot of hiccups, but that's exactly what happened. As I started small, I didn't invest in things which I didn't need. I knew what I needed because I had done pottery for 10 years before. Mm-hmm. I knew the things that you needed. I knew that I may not need about, if some another studio would take 3 wheels, I had just maybe one initially. Where someone would have 3 kilns, I had 1 kiln. So I was quite sure of my budget. Mm-hmm. And I think this was meant to happen because my students kept on coming. And then I got bigger projects, like I worked with school, where we did a project for school. So there was lump sums that were coming in that time. So like if I did...
So that would sustain the show.
Yeah. So if I knew that if I was going to get one, like I did, I work for different studios. So if I work there, I get, you know, payment and it comes as a lump sum so that I can put back into my business.
So I want to go back a little bit in the past. Yeah. You were doing pottery as a hobby.
Complete. I did it because I had I always wanted to do and I was not working, as I said. So
it was just for fun.
For fun.
Purely for fun. How did you then decide that this is the hobby that needs to be converted into a business?
Because I think when I started looking for a job, when it was decided that, you know, I need to work now.
You could have been a cook.
I could have. Kitchen. Yeah, but you know, for that, again, being in terms of chef or cooking, which I love, but you need other licenses and it's not easy to get that. And I didn't have that kind of funding where I could look and open a restaurant or... And I didn't And I didn't think all this would happen so suddenly. So I thought, okay, let me try and make my hobby my profession. So I thought it, I started small, but I wanted it a licensed. I didn't want something illegal. So I found out, and because I have a teaching, I teach, you have to go through Knowledge Village and have a KHD approval, which my business is. So that's how I started. And I then approached schools. But I think what the good part with my business was, I could sustain it with myself.
So how did you do the pricing? How did you come up with the right pricing
model? I
think
I took a lot, took a lot of clues even from my pottery teacher, who because I had seen her running a studio.
Okay, so that
so,
was a,
yeah, that was a benchmark.
Like a role model.
Yes. So I did ask her, I also went formal training with her to ask her as to how you could run a pottery studio. That's how she told me about basic, you know, you'll need this and the clay should be this cost and this. So then accordingly, I got to know that this is how we can manage it. Mm-hmm. But of course, over time, I realized that your model, someone else's model are completely different.
So right. It's because, the same pottery lesson.
Yeah. But how I deal with it and maybe her profit margin, she would like it to be much higher because what we were, you know, it was different from what I did completely. I did it for about a year, then I realized that there can be a little. So now I give my students a lot of liberty. Like, I don't particularly charge when they make a piece and you fire. Like, we were told that once you fire a piece, you have to weigh it and you have to charge it accordingly.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, which I don't, because I believe that some things come passionately, Namita. So I feel that you can't put a price tag on everything. So I think people don't come now to touch of clay, they come to me.
Yeah,
I think so. This is what is another fear I have, that if I have another teacher, my students will then say, no, but we don't want her. Yeah. We want you.
Yeah,
because I have tried it once. I did, you know, put it forward to some of my old students that, you know, I'm going to have another person. They said, no, but we are going to come to you. So you create a brand, but I think the brand is all about how you do it.
People buy people. I always believe that people
absolutely
do business with people.
Yeah, you cannot be saying that, you know, touch of clay is touch of clay. It's touch of clay because I made it touch of clay.
Yeah.
It's got my passion, my dreams. And today I see it at another level. I want to take it at another level.
But you cannot do it by still doing everything yourself.
Yeah, and
you have to.
I
so how are you going to cope with that?
I need firstly investments, which I need an investor to come into the picture, which I'm trying. I want someone to invest in my business so it gets bigger.
But how will you deal with that problem that people want to only be with
Mubarakka? We have to clone another Mubarakka.
You have to clone another Mubarakka. And I also believe, you know, I had a similar issue. I thought only I can make great campaigns. And the minute Mubarakka, I started training my team, giving them whatever I know. They could do other campaigns 10 times better than I could do, by the way.
Yeah. Maybe.
They are younger than me. All my team is, you know, under 25 and they are much more hands-on with social media. I had to give them the mind and they could take it to the next level altogether.
Maybe you're right. It could be my own fear that I don't want to let go.
It is. And I'm the experience of that. I've faced this. I've seen this in my business as well. Until it was just me doing one, I could only do that much because we have only
That's
two hands and those 10 hours in a day or 15 hours, how much can you work? You're a human being. You need to eat, you need to sleep, you need to have that, you know, rejuvenation time and stuff like that. But the minute I started hiring people, and they also come with their own luck and fate, by the way, because they also bring business with them.
Yeah.
Like how when they say when more kids are born in the family, they bring their own fate. Similarly,
That's true.
As we hire more people or hire more help or have bigger teams or as we grow our teams, only when it's right time to invest, only when you can afford to pay to or hire more help or have more people, is that's when you should plan to grow. And that's how actually, that is what is called reinvesting in your business.
Right.
The more you as an entrepreneur get free from doing the work, the more you can be on the business and think of growth. Now imagine all this time that you're spending in running the show.
Yeah.
You had this time to think of what new types you can do, how else you can
Absolutely.
Expand, where else can you
yes.
move. Right now you're with the students all the time, just teaching them.
No, I definitely want to, but I think, as I said, it could be my fear too, that will there be someone else who'll take, and if she's better than me or, you know, she or he. So you do have that, but saying that, for me right now, it's financially.
Mm-hmm.
If I had a little more financial support as an investor, I think I would take some more risk. I do want to take risk.
But then you would not be the owner of your company. Once you have an investor, you would be answerable to third party who would want to know what is the return you're bringing for their business.
Yes, I'm looking at a sleeping partner.
Maybe they want to charge by weight.
Yeah. No, I'll probably look at someone who is just ready to invest, not interfere in my business.
I'm going to actually very soon have a guest who's going to talk about funding and investment in the coming future. So, and how did they get funding for their business? Right. They raised quite a few million dollars for their venture, and how did that happen? And more detail on that. So that's going to be a separate talk actually on that. But yeah, hopefully you will also learn a lot from
there. But how did you decide to be an entrepreneur? What was your turning point in your life?
I had no choice.
Oh, you had no choice.
Okay. I was only given option to do a business. That was the only option. Because my father, I come from a very, actually I was just telling Mubarakka, somebody should actually interview me to take out my story.
Yeah.
So I come from a very affluent family back in India. And in our family, women don't work. They don't do jobs. So I would go and get a job, and since I'm 16, I was very passionate about digital marketing, and I always wanted to do something with digital. I would learn all these courses, and I'm a self-study student. I'm a self-learner. I've not taken a digital marketing degree, but the amount of books that I read and the amount of trainings I have and the amount of courses I go to, you cannot even imagine.
Wow, yeah.
So I got a job for myself, and I told my father, look, I've got this job. He's like, take double the salary and sit at home.
Oh, wow. Okay. But I'm glad you did not.
I'm glad, yeah. I think the more I was stopped to not do, the more I wanted to do. And there's actually there's a long story. It'll require a separate episode because it's a lot. I know I don't want to kind of move from your story to my story.
But I think we all have a common ground. We all have an inspiration that has taken us to this level.
Yeah.
And I think that is more important. You should have the urge to do something.
Yeah.
Don't give up. I could have easily given up after a year.
When was a time when you wanted to actually give up? Was there a time?
I think there was a time when, because I work from a garage and it's an open.
And you still work from a garage.
Yes. And
she still works from her backyard.
Yeah, so that is my workshop, and I teach at various other institutes and studios. Yeah. But I think when it was my first summer and it was 45 degrees outside, and I was like, really? I'm going to stand in this heat. And there was a Saturday class where I was working from morning 8 to evening 8. And I was drenched in sweat. And I was like, is it really, this is what I'm made for? And I realized you need to get that sweat out a little to achieve something in life. And I decided this is not going to put me down. I have come a long way.
So what was that self-talk you did to yourself?
I think never give up. Never give up. Even with clay, that's what I tell my students. It's such a medium. You can never give up. It never lets you give up. You can keep on working on it. It'll never give up.
What was the motivation to stand in that 45 degrees heat?
I think it was probably also, I had a son who was that time going to go to university, and I didn't want financial issues to come in the picture, or because if I couldn't have sent him abroad, I wanted things to fall in place also. So it was very important for me to let go. And the most thing, Namita, I feel was, I had started to do something after taking a break for 12 years, okay? I did never wanted to be a loser, that I couldn't do it. I had decided the day Touch of Clay came, this cannot be not successful. Because if it was, I'm telling you, I would not have survived it. I would have thought like, shit, man, nothing, I couldn't do anything out of my life.
Yeah.
And I had been very dejected, depressed from inside. Now I know when people say, what is depression? I would have been depressed because I would have thought like, really, it's true. I can't do anything.
Yeah.
People around me I have friends who are entrepreneurs, they have businesses, or they are working in top companies. I think some of my friends are pilot, CEO of a company. Then you feel, what have you done? And I'm educated. It's not that. And I didn't use my education. I've used my skill. So to all youngsters or whoever's listening, have a skill in life, because a skill can get you two meals to eat.
Mm-hmm.
Your degree can even make you lose a job, mm-hmm. but your skill cannot. Today, just my skill, pottery is not my, I have no degree.
Mm-hmm.
I have just years of experience. I've learned it now for 10 years and I've taught for 5, and I think while teaching I've learned much more than what I did when I was learning.
Okay.
because my students have taught me.
Yeah.
Today, if you remember, you know, when you had made that beautiful piece for your parents, the wings.
Yeah.
I think I was like, wow, this is so beautiful. It looked gorgeous. It's a different story. You didn't keep it.
It was not perfect according to my standards, and I had to let
yeah.
it go.
No. So that I think, and what gives me a lot of happiness is when my students work, when I see that my student, or I get recognition for, you know, my students' work. All on my Instagram and my Facebook is all my students' work. Nothing is mine. So when you see those, you know, 1,000 likes or people have reached, you're like, that feeling of content.
Yeah.
That I'm spreading this message. And I think over years, I've just had one student who was a little unhappy with me. I don't know why, but she was. She left, you know, with not a very good taste in her mouth. Mm-hmm. If she's listening, I have nothing against her. She can come back.
Yeah.
So, but I think yeah. Life teaches you how to deal with it. And I think clay was an extremely good medium for me. But I also would tell you at this point, Namita, that you have to get hurt in life. That is my motto. That if you don't get hurt, you'll not do it. I think at that point, I felt that, what is my use? What am I doing? I felt that I'm not doing anything. You know, I'm not working. I think at that point, my son also was, you know, in grade 9. He didn't need me. He was going to go to university. And I felt that if I had a job, we would not have been in the situation where we, you know, my husband could have easily taken his time off, or, you know, didn't have to wait for some amount of time. We could have gone ahead. Mm-hmm. And I come from that kind of upbringing. I lost my father very early. My sister started working at 18. Sometimes I feel why I didn't do it. I've yet not got the answer. The answer could be that a touch of clay was waiting to happen.
Yeah.
And today, I think I feel proud of myself also. I've been featured in all the newspapers. I mean, people know about me, like, I'm more known as touch of clay. Like, you know, that's how people, and Namita has also called me because of that, of course. So I think that's a good journey.
I think there's so much to learn from this conversation. One is, so much I'm learning, like, This thing that Mubarakka shared, that if that wouldn't have been a success,
yeah.
she wouldn't have been able to face herself.
I wouldn't have looked
there
in the mirror.
There was no option
yeah. exactly.
to not do it.
Exactly.
That is a very, very inspirational. I think something similar what happened with me as well. I mean, there's no option of failure. We have to make it happen.
Yeah.
The company has to run, you know.
Where you get the funds from, where does the rent come from?
Ethically, it,
yeah.
has, to happen.
It has to happen.
So that was like a goal. I think all of us entrepreneurs who want to live their dreams or want to venture out and do something in life and do that dream job or dream business or whatever it
yeah.
is, that fire has to be in the belly to
yes.
be able to do it.
Exactly.
This is one learning. There was quite a few actually you shared. As you were sharing, I was actually making a note of them in my mind. I've got lost track of thoughts. But, and skill, yeah. Invest in your skills.
Yeah.
Invest in your learning. There's always, it's never too late to take a training or to learn something new.
Also with children, Namita, sometimes we say, no, you study. We don't get them to do a skill.
Yeah.
Why are we giving so much emphasis on that you should be a topper or you should... No. If you have a skill, even if you do not study, you can do much better
yeah.
than even someone who's come from Harvard.
Yeah.
So it's just about even your attitude. You have to have the right attitude. Have the attitude. Yeah. Whatever happens, I'm at 8 o'clock in my studio, whether I am ill or not. If I have a student coming, like I'm going for 3 days out of town, I organized my full week, I've informed everyone, I'm not there, I made the classes up. So I think that also helped. You have to have really good organization skills.
But as women, anyway, we have it, don't you think?
Yeah, well, okay.
I'm sure a lot of women would relate that organization skills are like...
I think we can multitask,
yeah.
which men cannot. Yeah,
probably.
Let's not get into this men negative issue.
Yeah, yeah, they have their own skills and we have
I
our
think
own
which,
skills.
And we can, under pressure... I think
yeah.
I perform well under pressure. When I know that, okay, I have to do this, I manage to do it. Like I work 3 times a week at a studio in Meredith. So the time it came up to me, I was like, every day I'm driving 1.5 hours for an hour class.
Mm-hmm.
But no, when I see kids, I teach them. And I'm not lying. You need the money too. So it's my bread and butter for me.
Yeah.
So when I'm doing a class like that, I definitely would calculate, okay, this would, you know, give me this kind
yeah.
of... So in the end, even that's very important.
Yeah.
you can't live on love, air, fresh air, and you know, you need...
And you do mistakes as well a lot of times, but when you've committed, I believe that you should stick to your commitments and do it no matter what.
Don't give up. You will face with situations where you will want to give up, you're like, no, this I can't do it. Or, you know, someone has put you down. Someone has said that, you know, your business is horrible, or you've lost a contract. Or, like, I feel very bad sometimes when a student leaves my class, says, I'm not coming back.
Yeah.
The reason could be she's leaving town. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not that about me. It's not that they'll... But you take it personally.
Yeah.
But I think that keeps you going. You need to have that. Like, when you lose a contract, you should feel bad about it. If you're just going to say that, it's okay, I'll get another one. No, you will get another one. But you have to feel bad why you lost that contract.
And do everything to get another one.
Exactly. So even with my students, and I always have new things I'm trying out. Like, now I want to do some workshops with an artist from India. Or I want to take a retreat, pottery retreat.
That's fantastic idea.
You know, to different places and different, like there's a lady in Chandigarh who started a similar thing in a home. Mm-hmm. And she gives a full home as a retreat. They do a yoga class in the morning. She has a pool. Then you do pottery for 3-4
That's
hours.
Fantastic idea.
Yeah. And I think they say, you know, any student who comes to me will ask me, I'm not creative. You don't need to be creative. Yeah. It's all here, up in your mind.
Yeah.
And think with your heart, just come and...
I think one of the reasons that I came, because I work on digital, right? So I'm always making campaigns, or we're on Facebook, I'm reading, or I'm sharing my knowledge, or training. And I wanted to have something made with my hand.
Yeah.
Like, what can my hand make?
And therapy. And just imagine feeling. And I think my class is more of clay. We also have therapy sessions.
Yeah.
Where people are discussing from their, own problems, issues, which... they know that someone in the class is not going to be judgmental.
Yeah.
There's no judging. You're having a bad day with your husband, your boyfriend. So I've had girlfriend, boyfriends coming from my class, couples. From, I shouldn't be saying some things, but I've had all kinds. I've had mother, daughter.
One thing you wish you knew when you started out, what it'd be? And if there's anything you would do differently, what would that be?
Differently, I don't think what I've done I'm happy about. Only thing I wish I had more funding. I would have started my studio in a little more different manner. But saying that, I think what would I change?
Nothing. I don't think there's anything to change.
Yeah, I think
it's all perfect the way it is.
It is perfect because I think I've molded it.
Yeah.
It's like my baby, okay? I have decided my supply of clay. No one has told me how to go about it. Not work for 12 years. I didn't know you have to get a license even to get your clay at the port.
Okay.
Yeah, you have to go to Dubai, Dubai Customs and get a license for that. Apply online, go to a freight forwarding company. The amount of things I have learned, Namita, in these 5 years is amazing. I didn't know I could
make... When you do it, you learn it.
And you make mistakes, yeah? Definitely. I may have made an error and my clay was lying in the pot for about 3 days. But then I got that done. It came.
Yeah.
And the glazes. And today, I know so much about my business that I'm in a position to help someone to start a pottery studio.
Yeah.
And I would love that my some student tells me I want to start a studio. That will be my gift. I mean, I would love that. That's how I teach my students.
Yeah.
So I may, I may not have people who help me,
mm-hmm.
but I'd love to take help from my students. Like I do. When I go on a big project, I take my students to help me out.
So another learning here I would like to point out is feel abundant. Just because your student or someone you shared with wants to start something that you have doesn't mean that there's not enough for you, you know. I face this problem as well a lot of times that I share ideas with people and I suddenly see them doing these ideas and actually doing better than me or maybe going ahead of me. I feel envious, but then I think I was having actually a similar conversation this morning with another friend. I like all this in-depth conversations, you know.
And that's what we do in pottery, right? Sometimes the conversations we have at the
studio. So
he's
like, if you have more people doing, like he shared a very nice story actually. Can I share the story?
Sure.
So there was a beach and I don't know if Anjan is listening to me, but there's a beach. People go to the beach for beach. One day an ice cream a person decided to open an ice cream parlor there, like a little van of ice cream. He opened one in the middle of the beach. Not all the people who are coming to beach are going to come for ice cream, because people go to beach for beach, right? So there was this one ice cream station in the middle, in the center. So some people would come and some would not come. After a certain weeks, a couple of months, one more person decided to open up an ice cream center.
Okay.
So they split the beach into half. So half is yours, half is mine. So now there are two ice cream parlors. There's one on this side and one on that side. In a couple of months' time, two more people opened up ice cream parlors. Now there are four ice cream parlors on that one same beach. It suddenly became an ice cream beach.
Wow.
So, you know, it created a market. Now everybody who thought of going for an ice cream decided to go to the ice cream beach. And that's how Kite Beach was formed. Maybe one day some guy must be doing kite surfing. Yeah. And 10 people started doing, then 20 people. And it became Kite Beach, you know. So it created a market.
Exactly.
And suddenly, and the more people come and teach what you know, the more there is market for people to actually take things.
Yeah? Absolutely. In fact,
feel abundant.
I think when I started 5 years down the line, I've seen so many potters coming up. I've seen that people have got interest and it's got so much therapy value.
Yeah.
Literally, I had someone that day who called me to ask me that, you know, we are going through a lot of stress and my doctor has advised me to come to your pottery class.
Yeah.
So we need to invest a little in ourselves.
Yeah.
And I think that will take you much ahead in life.
Yeah.
Then, you know, with the, you go and buy a branded dress or a branded dress, a shoe or a bag. But I think investing in your own skills will definitely take you ahead in life.
Yeah.
I mean,
so many nuggets to take away today. You know, feeling abundant, investing in your skill. Another very important thing I would like to, you know, one thing you shared was teaching. Teaching what you do.
Yeah.
Because when you start teaching, you actually, the biggest benefiter when you teach is you.
Yeah, absolutely.
To teach,
absolutely.
I have to do so much learning. Like when I do workshops on digital, that's where my business actually started growing multiple times.
Yeah.
When I started teaching digital marketing, because to teach that subject on content, the amount of resources I would go to and read to kind of share the content would be so much more. So the maximum benefiter would be me. We teach this in our 7 Habits class and also in our cash flow club, wherein you teach to learn to teach.
Right. Okay.
You learn the most when you teach. So another tip, if you have a skill that you want to master, maybe convert it to a business,
teach.
So start teaching.
And
eventually, automatically, it'll become a business.
And I think share what you know.
Yeah.
Because sometimes as a teacher, you feel a little bit, if I share, she'll go on her own.
Yeah.
But no, if you share, she's going to share it back. And that sharing will create a chain.
Yeah.
I think I've learned so much in the last 5 years that I have no regrets.
So Mubarakka, how can people find you to work with you?
My studio is called Touch of Clay. And you can go on Facebook, Instagram. And just send me an email and we'll get back to you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Namita,
Thank you so much for
having me over.
Thank you,
Mubarakka. It was so nice.
I hope all of you enjoyed this conversation. If you enjoyed it, please like or love it. So I know that you enjoyed what we shared, the conversations that we had, because otherwise there's no other way for me to know. If you're watching a replay of this session, leave a comment or like and love it again. If you feel a friend or a family member needs to watch this video and maybe have that little push in life to go out there and do something or live their dreams, tag them in the comments or share this video on your wall to spread the message to more and more people on these inspirational stories.
I think that's the best way of going ahead.
Thank
you.
Thank you all again. And before we end, I would like to also share that I speak a lot in conferences and seminars, and a lot of you who are listening here are also entrepreneurs and small business owners. And you know, you guys, a lot of you actually are meeting these conferences. They come up to me and tell me, Namita, we've launched a business. Now we have a website and we have all these things, but how do we make these social media fans and followers into our real customers? And I have actually put together a course. It's a simple 4-step formula that you can do to see your social media fans and followers convert into your customers. And I've made a small little free video that you can find on this link. It's called abovedigitalacademy.com/4steps. I will put this also in the comments so you can visit this link, where I teach you the process of what it will take to convert your fans and followers into actual customers. Until next Monday, I hope you enjoyed this conversation. See you all next Monday and have a lovely week. Thank you. Bye-bye. And let's